In this presentation, the main objective is try to show you which one was the toolkit that we have adopted in Brazil, and then we have extended also to try to follow the track, to track the spread and emergence of emerging viral pathogen worldwide, like in a local as well as in a large scale. But before everything, I really would like to try to point out really nice aspect, which is now called genomic surveillance as well as genomic epidemiology, that for me is supposed to be like a novel way to do science, right? Like a novel phenomenal way to do science. But actually with genomic surveillance and epidemiology, we can be able to try to reconstruct the history and to try to follow the spread of a specific viral pathogen. And actually this kind of technology combines several kinds of data and analysis, including, for example, the combination of environmental data, evolutionary data, epidemiological data, as well as ambiental one. And how, what is really, really important, trying to understand how all of those data and all of those analyses are actually able to act and potentially interact to try to shape the viral phylogenies. Considering this fact, I think that one of the main objectives, try to understand why appear to be absolutely challenging, try to obtain complete genome sequence from emerging viral pathogens. Because actually we know that full-length genomes contain much more information compared to partial strains, right? So in this sense, we will be able, by analyzing in deep complete genome sequence, we can have the possibility to try to understand and to try to detect possible site mutations that can also explain differential clinical outcomes. And as I said, all of this concept is really applied to the real-time genomic epidemiology, which means the generation of complete genome data to quickly inform or trigger epidemiological investigation and outbreak control measures. But which one's supposed to be, I think, phylogenomic, I can say like a question that can be addressed by the using and application of those techniques. Inference that cannot be applied or answered by using, for example, just molecular assay as well as serological assay, right? So, for example, with the use of phylogenomic inference, we can be able to try to detect, investigate, and understand, for example, if strain are associated with certain transmission route. And here I'm reporting you the case of yellow fever virus, right? So we know that actually yellow fever is composed by a really complex transmission dynamics. So yeah, it includes actually the sylvatic jungle cycle as well as the urban one. And in each one, we have several vectors, including, for example, in the same one, the sabaetes and the hemagogus that play such an important role. And in the second one, we have the Aedes aegypti mosquitoes that play an important role and are able to infect the one that we consider to be the last host, which is humans. Well, by using those techniques, phylogenetic inference, we can be able to detect if a specific outbreak can be related to a sylvatic as well as urban cycle. And how we'll be able to detect this? By taking a look at the viral phylogeny, right? So in the case of the sylvatic cycle, we will see that strains from human and non-human primates, monkey, will be like interspersed among them. And in the case of course, urban cycle, we will see like a different spatial distribution. But also with the use of those techniques, we can be able, for example, to try to understand how fast a specific viral pathogen is it transmitting and in which kind of direction. So in this article, Nuno Faria et al, they describe the reemergence of dengue virus in Southeast Brazil, and using the combination of genomic data with epidemiological data, they were able also to estimate the viral fluctuation which represent the effective reproductive number, which mean which is the exact expected number of cases directly generated by one case in one population where all individuals are actually susceptible to the infection. But the other really nice stuff is that by using those techniques, we can be also able to try to understand which one is the direction of spreading, right? And this is the one that we used to call like phylogeography. By using those techniques, and again, we will need to be able to combine the information of genomic data with geolocalized information, we can be able to finally reconstruct the dispersion dynamics in a really local as well as lab scale. Another important application is try to determine where a specific epidemic likely started and where did it come from. In this really nice manuscript from Sally et al. That was published in Science, they reconstruct the epidemiological scenario in Thailand within 2016-2017, where they detected actually the co-circulation of several dengue serotypes. And actually, by combining genomic data with epidemiological as well as mobility data, they were able to identify that really high density population regions were also played such an important role also for viral diversity. Another kind of application is supposed to be, for example, try to understand how different hosts can be epidemiologically linked. And in this amazing manuscript from Arias, they describe one breastfeeding transmission dynamics in the case of Ebola virus. In this case, they were able not just to detect the presence of the virus in the breast milk, but they were also able to try to understand how the virus was able to persist in different way, in different times, in different body fluids. And the last application, I think, which is absolutely amazing, is also try to use those techniques for viral prediction. Moiz is just an amazing scientist and he used also to collaborate with us. In this paper, he combined information within epidemiological, ambiental, as well as human mobility data to try to detect in Angola two districts, Luanda and Lobito, that were selected and that were proposed to be prioritized for vaccination strategy for yellow fever, because they actually presented like a combination of factors that can really be related to, for example, possible future outbreak caused by yellow fever virus. And this is actually, as I can say, like the entire workflow that we are that we implemented in Brazil and in South America, which is based, of course, on the concept of genomic epidemiology, and is a kind of complex combination, of course, of dry and wet lab, where we, of course, start with the molecular screening. So we use RT-qPCR to test positive as well as negative sample, and then we proceed with the selection of the positive sample that of course are submitted to NGS, and then we combine, we analyze the genomic information that is containing the genomic sample with the epidemiological data as well as ambiental data, depends on the kind of the virus that we are looking for, to try to reconstruct the epidemiology of and the history of a specific viral pathogen. And this is just a little bit more in detail the entire workflow. Of course, as I said, the molecular screening, then we have the library preparation, the sequencing using nanopore sequencing, but also other kind of technology, the analysis of this huge amount of data that are generated, and then, of course, the complex association within the strain that we have generated. But
when everything started, actually, those activities started in within 2015, 2016, in West Africa, in Sierra Leone, where we follow the spread actually of the Ebola virus, the emergence, I want to say. And actually, we decided to implement the one that we used to call like the lab in a suitcase. So we decided to follow the Ebola epidemic. We were working two different sites in Ghana, where they adopted the use of the nanopore sequencing, and I had the privilege to work in Sierra Leone. But there we used actually the ion torrent technology. Well, we were... reported some pictures that described those activities. Actually, we used to work in a treatment center, which was a kind of collaboration with in the Italy and Public Health London. And actually, we were, this was actually the our, it was not a mobile lab, but it was a temporary one. Here we performing like molecular screening. And then, as I said, we also performed the next generation sequencing. Actually, those activities in Sierra Leone were focused, of course, in trying to give a quick response to the Ebola epidemics, but of course we were absolutely also interested in transfer technology. So we realized a really large program to try to make local people able to adapt the use of those technology and likely be able to respond to any other possible outbreaks. And then we decide actually to repeat the same experience, to extend the same experience also in Brazil, in Latin America, when actually within 2015, 2016, when of course Brazil registered the emergence of this new threat of international concern that was the Zika virus epidemic. We know that actually in first February 2016, also the WHO declared state of emergence of international concern due to an exponential number of notified cases of microcephaly. But actually, which one is supposed to be like the pathogenetic mechanism, so how the virus was able to generate these differential clinical outcomes, those questions were like, we didn't have a really strong connection within the association between Zika virus and microcephaly, and actually this was why we really realized that there was at the time a really huge paucity of complete genome sequence. So we realized that for 10,000 notified cases in Brazil, there was just a really small number, like 1.2 genomes were generated per time. So this was why we decided to try to improve and strengthen the genomic surveillance in the country by implementing for the first time the use of the nanopore technology. And since then, actually, our activity started. So we provide we try to provide information regarding the transmission dynamics of these emerging viral pathogens in South America. In collaboration with the University of Oxford, we also estimate the one that we used to call like evolutionary rate, which means the number of substitutions per site per year accumulating the viral genome. For Zika is 10^-3, which is in line with other arboviral, with other RNA viruses, and also we date back the introduction events of the Zika virus in America that was dated back in 2014. And then we try to combine this information with also mobility data to try to understand which one were likely the events that were registered at that time. And we realized that actually two events, the World Cup and the Confederation Cup, were likely mediated this introduction. And again, we highlight how important was the human mobility, you know, like the role that human mobility played to allow to the introduction of these emerging viral pathogens, not just in Brazil, but of course in South America. And then with the aim to try to get a little bit more insight regarding the possible connection
within the infection caused by Zika virus, as well as the differential clinical outcomes, we also investigate this case, and we were able to sequence and also to isolate the virus in different body fluids of a newborn with affected with a severe congenital syndrome, and we were able also to detect and isolate the virus in the breast milk, in the mother breast milk. So we were able to discuss not just like a mother to child transmission, but also to discuss the capacity of this virus to persist in different times, in different body fluids. And as I said, due to the success in the use of those lab in sweet case in Sierra Leone, in East Africa in general, we decide to replicate this experience also in Brazil. And this was why actually this project Zebra was born. So the main objective was try to track in real time the emergence and the spread of the Zika virus in Brazil and the Americas. And for the proposal, actually, we also develop one protocol to try to give us the possibility to amplify. It was a multiplex PCR protocol to try to amplify the entire coding region of the Zika virus. And in the same time, we also develop these two, which is an online one, which is called the Primal Scheme. So the Primal Scheme is able to generate for us a multiplex primer scheme for the pathogen that we are looking for. The only input that we need to provide is a FASTA file containing at least five complete genome sequence from the strain and from the virus that we are looking for, and is able to generate this multiplex tiling primer scheme. So the primer scheme is actually composed of two different pools to prevent primer dimer and, of course, excess of primer that are overlapping. So, but nowadays, actually, we are trying to implement and to develop, I can say, like, a kind of multiplex primer scheme that can be also, like, ultra-long reads all around, for example, 2 kb for each app. And this was actually the workflow that we have adopted during the Zika epidemic. So at that time, we estimated that the entire workflow will take at least 3 days. And at that time, we were able to generate in 3 days around 12 or 24 samples. So nowadays, also the techniques has changed a lot. And actually nowadays in at least 24 hours, we will be able to obtain more than 96 samples. And I remember that actually the Zebra that I showed you, this project was actually a mobile one. And I remember that one day before starting our mobile trip in Northeast Brazil, we were able to obtain our first complete genome sequence from Zika virus with a really high genome coverage of about 99%. But then we realized during our mobile trip that our first version of protocol was really not working properly. And it was that we realized that it was a really correlation within the CT value and the coverage. So for really high CT value, we were not really able to obtain a coverage that was considered like satisfactory. And this was why also in real time, we tried to adjust our multiplex scheme, and we obtained the second version that really worked with a coverage that was even, it was better and more even. So as I said to you, the project was a mobile one, so we use a mobile lab that gave us the possibility like to test and screen samples that were located in Northeast Brazil. In 15 days, we screened more than 1,400 human samples, and also in a One Health context, we also extend those activities and we collect more than 800 mosquitoes. We decide and we chose the Northeast region because actually, and without any doubt, it was the region that reported the majority number of notified cases. and in the same time was also, so was the region, of course, most affected by the Zika virus epidemic, and also was the region that reported also the majority number of notified cases of microcephaly. Those are just some pictures from our mobile activity. So we used to perform the nanopore sequencing within the this mobile lab that was a bus. And of course, those activities gave us the possibility to obtain in 15 days, and at that time this sounds like a really huge number, 54 complete genome sequence from Zika virus. We know that actually nowadays this number sounds a really small one. In 2 years of pandemic, this international cooperation system allowed the generation of more than 9 million complete genome sequence. That was really the genomics revolution, right? But actually the analysis of those genomes gave us the possibility to really reconstruct the history of the Zika virus epidemic in Brazil as well as in South America. So we date back the introduction events of Zika virus that was dated to January 2014. We decided to call this kind of transmission cryptic one because actually the first autochthonous cases was just confirmed in April, May 2015. So we don't know what happened during this lag time. So maybe this not previous identification was mainly due to a misclassification with other arboviruses already endemic in Brazil, such as yellow fever as well as dengue. But actually the phylogeographic application also give us the possibility to identify that the northeast part of the region plays such an important role in the introduction of the virus in South America, and that since then the virus was likely spreading in the other Brazilian region as well as in the other South American countries. Then we also extend those activities to try to understand how complex was the epidemiological scenario in Brazil and how the virus transmission likely were to characterize the virus transmission in other parts of the country, including, for example, the north part, the state of Amazonas. So we detect multiple introduction events, but a really huge monophyletic clade, and we decide to try to find, reconstruct the transmission dynamics in a really small city, which was Manaus. So actually, this is just an example that to give you an idea of how those techniques in the application of phylodynamics can really give us the possibility to reconstruct the spread of a specific viral pathogen in a really large or in a really local scale. And then we extend those activities and we develop a protocol to also obtain complete genome sequence from another emerging viral pathogens, which is chikungunya in Brazil. We know that the first cases of chikungunya in Brazil were registered in 2014 when we realized the co-circulation of two distinct genotypes. The Asian one, which is supposed to be endemic just in the north part of the country, and the African one, the ECSA, that was endemic just in the northeast. By using those techniques, we were able to detect actually the circulation of the African genotypes also in the north part of the country, highlighting how crucial it appears to be, like, try to generate a really integrated system to try to monitor in real time the transmission dynamics of different viral pathogens. And then, of course, we extend those activities to try to understand how complex was the epidemiological Brazilian scenario that was actually characterized by the circulation, co-circulation, the reintroduction of several strains mediated by other Brazilian region, highlighting once again how human mobility, globalization, and so on can play such an important role. In 2016, 2017, it was December 2016, actually Brazil also registered the reemergence of yellow fever. This outbreak was considered like one of the main outbreaks never reported before, that was able also to achieve regions that presented a really low vaccination coverage.
So there was a really huge concern. Actually, we decided in collaboration with the Public Health Laboratory of Minas Gerais, which is such a huge state located in southeast Brazil, to quickly try to respond to this reemergence, try to understand if we were seeing like such an urban as well as a sylvatic cycle. And we developed again one protocol for the complete genome sequence of these viral pathogen. And actually we use the application of phylodynamics as well as phylogeography to try to reconstruct the dispersion dynamics of the virus, since the first cases that were registered in Minas Gerais and this dispersion in the other states, including São Paulo, Espírito Santo and Rio de Janeiro. Then in 2018, we also tried to investigate the biodiversity that is contained in such an amazing ecosystem, which is called Pantanal, located in Midwest Brazil. And actually we use a mobile lab. This time was a motor home, a really used one. And I can't remember how many kilometers we were able to actually before, but actually we in this project we try to combine of course portable genomes on the field, but also we implement large training program for local people to make them able to try to quickly detect potential emerging virus that are circulating in the region, including for example St. Louis, Mayaro, Rupus, as well as Wasnai. And at that time, for the first time, we also tried to develop and implement a metagenomic protocol for on-target viral pathogen discovery that was based, again, on the use of nanopore sequencing. And actually, we tried to validate this protocol by analyzing and sequencing the chikungunya sample, historical sample, by using the target protocol and the on-target one, the metagenomics, and we obtained with the metagenomics a really higher genome coverage, much higher than the one obtained by using the target protocol. And actually, in Midwest Brazil, we describe for the first time the reemergence of two distinct lineages of two different serotypes of dengue, dengue 1 and dengue 2. And we combine in these analyses actually not just the information contained on genomic data, but again the importance of epidemiological data and also the one that we used to call ambiental data, like temperature, precipitation, humidity, that give us the possibility to estimate the one that we used to call index P. The index P is able to estimate actually the viral suitability of the vector, right? And with the index P, actually, we were able to estimate like a synchronicity within the index P fluctuation as well as the different epidemic peaks that have occurred during time. And again, here I'm just showing you the results that we obtained from dengue 2 genotype 3, which is absolutely widespread in South America, and is actually the South American one. But the really important thing is that it was that actually we were able to identify a novel lineage that we used to call BR4, that was likely mediated by an introduction events from Caribbean. And then we were able within the BR4 to identify two different lineages that we used to call BR4 L1 and L2 that were characterized by lineage specific mutation. And then we also extend those activities to West Nile. So we detect the first cases of West Nile virus in Brazil by using nanopore sequencing. And again, we try to combine information with the epidemiological as well as ambiental data to try to identify and predict possible areas that need to be prioritized for genomic monitoring and surveillance in general. And this is really our last work. We detect for the first time the circulation of the cosmopolitan genotype of dengue 2 in South America. So we know that these are absolutely common in Asia, but we detect the first cases both in Goiás, which is located in Midwest Brazil, as well as in Peru. And this work was performed in collaboration with the CDC from Puerto Rico. Of course, we were also we tried at least to give our contribution to the SARS-CoV-2 epidemic. Pandemic, and actually we again use the nanopore sequencing to obtain complete genome sequence from this virus, both in Brazil, in Italy, as well as in South Africa. So this is just a really small part of our team. Again, I want to say, and I want to really stress this concept of the phenomenal new way to do science, actually in 2 years, almost 3, of pandemic, this international cooperation network on genomic monitoring allowed the generation of more than 9 million complete genome sequences from this virus. So, like, the time is now, I think. And I think that this just gives us the possibility to understand how important it is to try to implement a really huge and large training program and genomic monitoring effort to try to track and prevent the spread of any potential new threat worldwide. So this was actually happened really in real time, right? So since the first cases that were detected in the Asian continent, actually the generation of complete genome sequence, as I said, allowed the generation of more than 9 million genomes up to now. And as I said, we tried to follow the epidemics both in Italy, and I'm really happy to say that this work was also realized in collaboration with the Professor Marcello as well as with the ICGP. So again, in this work, we try to understand actually the Italian epidemic. So we again combine epidemiological and genomics information. So we describe the first 2 epidemic peaks and how we try to understand how also the different restriction measures have played such an important role, for example, in the community transmission and so on, in the sustained viral transmission. But I want to really say that when we used to talk about SARS-CoV-2, it is important to say that everything is absolutely dynamic. So this work was dated back November 2020. So at that time, we actually didn't have information about variant of concern as well as interest. So of course, this is not describing like the actual Italian scenario. But in this work, actually, we were also trying to understand how Italy play such an important role, like an importer as well as an exporter of the SARS-CoV-2 epidemics. So we noticed that the first epidemic step were, of course, mediated by introduction events, likely mediated by European as well as Asian countries. But then we realized that actually also with implementation of restriction measures, we observe a really huge community transmission in our country, and then we realized that actually Italy also plays such an important role in the viral exportation, mainly in South America. In March 2020, I had also the privilege to be invited in South Africa, in Durban, where we set up the lab to receive the first sample of SARS-CoV-2, and we implement down there also the use of nanopore sequencing. And this was actually our first
work where we describe actually the first step of the SARS-CoV-2 epidemic in South Africa, and we describe the circulation of 16 novel lineages, including at that time EC1. Time later, and this happened actually during our Christmas holiday, we also identify and we discover, we detect the one that nowadays we know to be like a variant of concern, the Beta 1, and then also the Omicron 1 that likely was detected the first time on November 2021. And then we try to, with a really huge network within Africa, we try to describe a year of genomic surveillance effort in South Africa, and we try to, in Africa in general, in the African continent, and we try to understand how the transmission dynamics of the virus was mediated by a complex transmission dynamics of different lineages. Also in Brazil, we try to provide a general overview, and actually this work was a really huge effort within all the Brazilian states and of course the Pan American Health Organization. So we analyze and we generate more than 10,000 complete genome sequence from SARS-CoV-2 from Brazil. And here we provide an overview regarding, again, the results of the Brazilian epidemic. So again, we saw actually that multiple introduction events occurred through time, and we detect that some region play such an important role in the progression of the epidemic. And again, actually here we also try to provide some insight regarding the complex transmission scenario, and again highlighting how human mobility plays such an important role in the dispersion of the two that we know to be gamma, a variant of concern, and zeta, a variant under investigation, which were actually two main Brazilian variants that have really mediated the Brazilian epidemic. But then we also try to investigate some other aspects linked to the SARS-CoV-2 infection, including the reinfection. So there was a huge discussion regarding the possibility to see protection and or reinfection with SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19 in general. And actually in Brazil, we detect the first, like the first reinfection cases that were confirmed again using this toolkit of molecular assay as well as complete genome sequencing, where we investigate and we confirm the different viral infection. But also we try to describe the one that we used to know, like the SARS-CoV-2 persistence. This work was performed in collaboration with the professor Arnaldo Caruso of the University of Brescia. And we detect actually the persistence of SARS-CoV-2, and also we describe the one that we used to call like intra-host evolution in immunocompromised patients, where we detect the virus up to 10 months. And this is just our really last last work. Here we try to describe the one that we are seem to be like such a common mechanism, which is the variant replacement, and how they mediated like such, for example, increasing the number of cases as well as deaths in different countries. And here actually we were describing our gamma by delta, the replacing of the delta variant in Brazil. And during, we try to describe also how the delta variants really became dominant in the national scenario, and how complex was its transmission dynamics within the country. And also we try to understand a little bit more in detail also the Omicron emergence and its replacing to the delta variant. So as a really final step, I really want to say that actually I think that these genomic surveillance strategy appear to be absolutely fundamental to try to spread, but also to try to predict and detect quickly the emergence of any potential emerging viral pathogens. So with the use of this toolkit, we will be able, for example, to try to define the size of a specific outbreak as well as epidemic, try to estimate basic epidemic parameters like R0, RT, but we can also try to understand, for example, chain of transmission linked to the infection caused by a specific viral pathogen. But of course, we know that many outbreaks here remain for the routine implementation of real-time genomic epidemiology. Some of them are like, of course, the cost, the logistic, the analysis, which nowadays I think is really the stepping stone in this process, interpretation of data and the sharing one, beside if maybe with the sharing one we have made such a huge work with the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic. So this is supposed to be really the entire workflow, which is based on molecular virology, genome sequencing, bioinformatics, real-time analysis, molecular epidemiology, data visualization, interpretation, all of these, of course, which appear to be absolutely fundamental for outbreak response. And again, all of those activities actually were really, really linked to a large training program that we have implemented, not just for Brazilian states, but also for South American countries, including this huge training program that was performed in 2017, where actually those people were trained in both dry and wet lab techniques. So we follow with them the entire workflow, since the production of the genome sequence and then the analysis of the data obtained and generated in real time together. Also we perform in those kind of training program in South Africa, in collaboration with the African Union and the Africa CDC. So what's next? I think that actually the challenging things are supposed to be like really try to perform target and untarget surveillance sequencing anywhere, because really the time is now, and we have the opportunity in this bioinformatics and biotechnology revolution era that we are living to really perform these and to try to integrate those systems in our routine. So the two big protocols that we can try to adapt will be like the target one, which is supposed to be based on the application of a multiplex PCR that can give us the possibility to amplify the entire coding region of viral pathogen, on the untarget one, which of course are based on the viral metagenomics that can give us the possibility to discover things that are not circulating or circulating at really low frequency. So that is all. Thank you.